So today we'll be continuing with the human in health and diseases. So the human immune system we are going to discuss about. In the previous class, we had discussed about the various diseases caused by bacteria, protozoans, viruses, fungi. And we also discussed about the mode of transmission and symptoms of these diseases. So presently, we'll just discuss about the human immune system and how this immune system protects our body from various antigens. Whenever we use the word antigens, it implies foreign bodies. It can be virus, fungi, bacteria, or protozoan. So any of them it can be. So our body provides us the immunity. Only when our immune system fails, we are affected by diseases and disorders. So the immune system provides us the defense that we require from the foreign antigens. So we have an inbuilt immune system. So let us study about the types of immune system and the immune system in general. The structure of antibody we'll also be studying about. So the diagram oriented question that you can get from the board examination. So you should also concentrate on that. So let us proceed with this discussion of this human immune system. So the immune system, it is a system that gives immunity to the body. How does it provide immunity to the body? By recognizing, responding, and remembering foreign antigens. So it provides immunity to the body. The immune system provides immunity to the body by recognizing, that is identifying the antigen, responding, producing antibodies against them. And memory cells would be there, which remembers this foreign antigens. So there would be immediate production of antibodies the next time they infect, the same antigen infects us. So this is the immune system. Immune system is the system that gives immunity to our body by recognizing, responding, and remembering the foreign antigens. Okay. So the next important role is immune system plays a very important role in allergic reaction, autoimmune disease, and organ transplantation. So whenever there is an organ transplantation, so our body tries to reject those organs transplanted. So that is our immune system does that protect us from the foreign antibodies or foreign antigens. So the organ transplantation also, it plays an important role in allergic reaction, autoimmune disease, and organ transplantation. Okay. So the human immune system includes, what are those human immune system made up of? Lymphoid organs, lymph and the lymph systems. You can see the various nodes and the lymph. Okay. So the lymphoid organs, tissues, cells, and antibodies. Okay, so tissues, cells, and antibodies. There would be cell mediated immunity. Then the tissues would be having this capability to produce immunity. So the lymphocytes, so they of the WBC, they also provide us the immunity, and antibodies. So these are all the components of immune system. So the human immune system includes lymphoid organs, tissues, cells, and antibodies. Okay, so these are all just diagrammatic part of it, just for your understanding. Need not have to mug up these diagrams. So this is not there in your textbook. Okay, this is just to show you the distribution of lymphoid organs, the various tissues and cells, and antibody producing the regions. Okay, so the human organ transplantation, autoimmune disease, and allergic reaction. So the human immune system plays an important role in these activities. So next we'll be discussing about the first part of it, lymphoid organs. So these are the organs where the origin, maturation, and proliferation of lymphocytes. OMP, you can remember it as OMP. So origin, maturation, and proliferation of lymphocytes occur in the lymphoid organs. Lymphoid organs are of two types: primary lymphoid organs, secondary lymphoid organs. Okay, so the lymphoid organs are the organs which where origin, maturation and proliferation, that is multiplication of lymphocytes, occur. So lymphoid organs are of two types. So the primary lymphoid organs, secondary lymphoid organs. So the organs where lymphocytes are matured and differentiated to antigen sensitive lymphocytes, we call it as primary lymphoid organs, are the organs where lymphocytes so are matured and differentiated to antigen sensitive lymphocytes. Okay, so the lymphocytes are matured and differentiated to antigen sensitive lymphocytes, that is they react with antigen. So that sort of lymphocytes are matured and differentiated in these primary lymphoid organs. So where lymphocytes are matured and differentiated to antigen sensitive lymphocytes. So the two types, it is of two types, the primary lymphoid organs are of two types, bone marrow and thymus. So the lymphocytes produced by them will be the bone marrow lymphocytes and thymus lymphocytes, lymphocytes from the thymus. Okay, so it is of two types, the lymphoid, primary lymphoid organs, bone marrow and thymus. So thymus gland, you know about this, we have already studied in the previous academic year in the chemical coordination. So the thymus glands, so these are the primary lymphoid organs where lymphocytes are matured and differentiated to antigen sensitive lymphocytes, T lymphocytes and B lymphocytes. So the thymus origin lymphocytes and bone marrow origin lymphocytes we have. So it is of two types, the primary lymphoid organs, bone marrow and thymus. So the bone marrow is the primary lymphoid organ and thymus is also the primary lymphoid organs, which is thymus can be differentiated into right and left lobe. So bone marrow, the site of formation of all blood cells, including B and T lymphocytes. So the site of formation of all blood cells, that is RBC, WBC, including bone and thymus lymphocytes, is the bone marrow. So thymus is a bilobed organ seen near the heart and below the breastbone, beneath the breastbone. So our thymus is a bilobed organ seen near the heart and beneath the breastbone. So it is large, thymus gland is large during birth, but gradually reduces in size and becomes very small size at the time of puberty. So and becomes very small sized in puberty. So the immature T lymphocytes from bone marrow is migrated to thymus and matured. So the immature T lymphocytes from bone marrow are migrated to thymus and matured. But you should remember the B lymphocytes, T lymphocytes, the blood cells, all of them are produced in the red bone marrow, the bone marrow. Okay, there are two types of bone marrow, red bone marrow and yellow bone marrow. Red bone marrow, they produce the blood cells, T lymphocytes, B lymphocytes. Whereas the yellow bone marrow, they produce fat cells. Okay, and you should also remember that even though the T lymphocytes is produced in the bone marrow, for them to mature, so they migrate to thymus and they are matured in the thymus. So the immature T lymphocytes are produced in the bone marrow, which migrate to thymus and mature in the thymus. So thymus gland is very large during birth, but gradually decreases in size and becomes very small size in puberty. So the secondary lymphoid organs are spleen and lymph nodes. The organs to which matured lymphocytes migrate from primary lymphoid organs interact with antigens and then proliferate to become effector cells. So the organs to which mature lymphocytes migrate from primary lymphoid organs, they interact with antigens and then proliferate to become effector cells. Example, spleen and lymph nodes. So the secondary lymphoid organs are the organs to which matured lymphocytes migrate, that is spleen and lymph nodes. They migrate to this matured lymphocytes migrate from primary lymphoid organs. They migrate to these secondary lymphoid organs and they interact with antigens. Antigens are foreign bodies and then proliferate to become effector cells. So they interact with antigens and then proliferate to become the effector cells. So the secondary lymphoid are the organs to which matured lymphocytes migrate from primary lymphoid organ, that is the bone marrow and thymus. So they migrate from this bone marrow and thymus to the secondary lymphoid organs like spleen and lymph nodes. So the lymphocytes, they are going to migrate and they interact with the antigens, that is the foreign bodies, and then proliferate means they multiply. Okay, they increase in number and then proliferate, spread. Okay, and then proliferate to become effector cells. So examples of the secondary lymphoid organs are spleen and lymph nodes are the example for that. Spleen, you can find it near to the stomach region, you find the spleen. So the spleen and lymph nodes are the effector, the secondary lymphoid organs, spleen and lymph nodes. The lymph system, you can notice here and there, the swollen structures called as the lymph nodes. So example, spleen, lymph nodes, then you can see here tonsils. Okay, this is the eula and this is the tonsil. So towards the lateral side, Peyer's patches. So in the small intestine, so there is a region where you can find this Peyer's patches. Okay, if you take the section of small intestine, you can notice this Peyer's patches. So these are all the secondary lymphoid organs. So spleen, lymph nodes, spleen, lymph nodes, then tonsils, then Peyer's patches. Okay, so normal tonsils, this is how it looks. The inflamed tonsils, where you find the infected tonsils which have become swollen structures. So this is the inflamed tonsils. So normal tonsils are where they are normal in structure. The infected one will be having the inflamed or swollen tonsils. Okay, Peyer's patches are found in the small intestine. So this zone, we call it as the Peyer's patches. So they are all the secondary lymphoid organs, examples for secondary lymphoid organs. Apart from this, the mucosa associated lymphoid tissue, MALT we call it as. So the mucosa associated mucosa, the mucus layer associated lymphoid tissue. So the mucus layer, so you have this different layers in the alimentary canal, you have the in intestine, small intestine, if you take serosa, muscularis externa, muscularis interna, submucosa and mucosa. Mucosa is almost the outermost layer. So the mucosa associated lymphoid tissue, we call it as MALT. So MALT is also an example for secondary lymphoid organs. Appendix is also an example for secondary the lymphoid organs. So the secondary lymphoid organs are where the lymphocytes migrate and they are going to interact with antigens and then proliferate to become effector cells. So we'll study one by one these various secondary lymphoid organs. Spleen. So spleen is a bean-shaped organ. So spleen is almost a bean-shaped organs. It contains lymphocytes and phagocytes. So spleen contains lymphocytes and phagocytes. Okay. So the cell eating, we call it as phagocyte. Lymphocytes and phagocytes are found in the spleen. It's a bean-shaped organ. They contain lymphocytes and phagocytes. They remove, the function of spleen is to remove worn-out RBC and microorganisms from blood. So the function of the spleen is to remove the worn-out RBC and microorganisms from blood. So the spleen is also a reservoir of erythrocytes in fetus. So they in the fetus, they don't have bone marrow. So the spleen is the reservoir of erythrocytes, RBCs, in fetus. So you should remember about that. They are the storage region of RBCs in fetus, the spleen. So in fetus, there is no bone marrow formed yet. So the spleen is the reservoir of erythrocytes in fetus. So the spleen removes the worn out RBC and microorganisms from blood. That is the major function of it. It's a secondary lymphoid organ. So they are bean shaped. So they contain lymphocytes and phagocytes. So these are the points that you should remember about. The lymph nodes, they are swollen structures found in the lymphatic system. So the lymph nodes, as you know, the lymphocytes migrate to the lymph nodes. They interact with the antigens, and they are going to form the effector cells. You know about that. So the lymph nodes are found in the lymphatic system. The lymph, the colorless fluid, it is the lymph. Lymph system, they will be having this found in the lymphatic system. The lymph nodes are there. So they trap microorganisms or other antigens. So the lymph nodes, they trap microorganism or other antigens. The trapped antigens activate lymphocytes and cause immune response. So the trapped antigens within this lymph nodes, they activate lymphocytes. So because of these, they react with the antigens and cause the immune response. So they are going to cause the immune response. So we'll not discuss about this. This is just the diagram part of the lymph node. Okay. So it is advanced. As of now, you have to remember these points. So where are the lymph nodes found? It's a secondary lymphoid organ. So lymph nodes are found in the lymphatic system. They trap microorganisms. So lymph nodes trap microorganisms and other foreign bodies. So the trapped antigens, they activate lymphocytes and they cause the immune response. The trapped antigens activate lymphocytes and they cause the immune response. Then the other secondary lymphoid organ is MALT. So MALT is also called as mucosa-associated lymphoid tissue. So this mucosa layer is located within the lining of respiratory, digestive, and urogenital tracts. You find this mucosa layer. So the MALT is located within the lining of respiratory, digestive, and urogenital tracts. It constitutes 50% of lymphoid tissues. So MALT constitutes 50% of lymphoid tissue, that is mucosa associated lymphoid tissue. So they are located within the lining of respiratory, digestive, and urogenital tracts. It constitutes 50% of lymphoid tissues. So the MALT constitutes 50% of lymphoid tissues. So they are found within the lining of the respiratory, digestive, and urogenital tracts. So MALT constitutes 50% of lymphoid tissues. Now the next that we will be discussing about is immunity. So how does our body provide immunity against the antigens? So that is what we are going to discuss about. So there is, in immunity, you should remember two things: the antigens or the foreign particles, which can be fungi, bacteria, protozoan, viruses, and the antibodies that are produced against these antigens. So antigen and antibody reactions are produced. So they are produced in response to antigens. So let us study about this immunity in human beings. So immunity, what is immunity? The ability of the human system to fight the disease-causing organisms. The capability of the human system to fight the disease-causing organisms, we call it as immunity. It is the ability of the immune system to fight against disease-causing organisms, we call it as immunity. There are two types of immunity: innate, so that is inborn immunity, acquired, or the adaptive immunities. So they are formed later. So innate is inborn immunity that is found within us from birth. Acquired is, it is acquired later on in the in our life cycle stages. So innate immunity is inborn. Acquired is adaptive immunity. Acquired immunity, you can also call it as adaptive immunity. So what is immunity? The ability of the immune system to fight the disease-causing organisms, we call it as immunity. So the capability of an immune system to fight the against the disease-causing organism, we call it as immunity. So types of immunity are of two types: the innate or inborn immunity, the acquired or adaptive immunity. So let us understand them in much more detail. See, innate immunity, It is a non-specific defense. It is not specific, it is non-specific. It provides defense from all types of antigen. That is why we call it as non-specific defense present at the time of birth. See, innate immunity is a non-specific defense which is present at the time of birth. It provides barriers to the entry of foreign agents into our body. So they are going to provide barrier, or it prevents the entry of foreign agents into our body. So the barriers are of four types: physical barriers, physiological barriers, cellular barriers, cytokine barriers. So innate immunity or inborn immunity, it is a non-specific defense present at the time of birth. Okay, from the time of birth, it provides barrier to the entry of foreign agents, that is the antigens, into our body. So they provide barriers, or it prevents the entry of foreign agents into our body. The barriers are of four types. The innate immunity barriers are of four types: the physical barriers, physiological barriers, cellular barriers, cytokine barriers. Okay. So the physical barriers. So the first line of defense, we also call it as skin, prevents the entry of foreign bodies. So skin that we have prevents the entry of foreign bodies unless and until there is an injury or a cut. So only then the foreign bodies can enter. So the physical barrier is first skin, which prevents the entry of foreign bodies. So mucus coating of the lining. So the mucus coating of the lining of the respiratory tract, gastrointestinal, and urogenital tracts. So they have this mucus coating to trap the microbes. Mucus coating to trap the microbes. So the mucus coating of the lining, the respiratory, gastrointestinal, and urogenital tracts to trap microbes. So we have this mucus coating. So that is also a physical barrier. Okay. So skin prevents the entry of pathogens. Then mucus lining there traps the dirts and microbes. The tears also have antibacterial enzymes. Saliva, lysozymes, they would be having it. Even tears has lysozymes. Saliva has lysozymes. They are antibacterial enzymes. The gastric HCl, the low pH kills the pathogens. The acidic nature of it kills the pathogen. So good gut bacteria, they are going to outcompete the bad bacteria. So the good gut bacteria, or the positive microbes which are present within our gut, so the tract, digestive tract, they are going to outcompete the bad bacteria. So these are all the first line of defense, physical barriers that we have. So we have just discussed about skin and mucus coating, so which lines the respiratory, digestive, or the gastrointestinal, and urogenital tracts, so which are meant to trap the microbes and dirt particles. Okay. The physiological barriers. So the first line of defense includes the skin. So the physiological barriers. So here we had the physical barriers. Now physiological barriers. So they prevent microbial growth. It includes the gastric acid, the gastric HCl, saliva, tears. So they are all going to be the physiological barriers. So physical barrier was skin. Physiological barriers are gastric HCl, saliva, tears. So they are the physiological barriers. The cellular barriers, the phagocytes like WBC. So you, the example, neutrophils or polymorphonuclear leukocytes, PMNL. So neutrophils, we also call it as polymorphonuclear leukocytes. So neutrophils or polymorphonuclear leukocytes, PMNL. So neutrophils, we also call it as polymorpho, that is many morphological variations of nucleus, polymorphonuclear leukocytes, we also call it as. So monocytes, they are the largest cells, you know about that in the WBC. So the monocytes and natural killers like lymphocytes. See, the leukocytes are different, that is the WBC, and natural killer cells like lymphocytes. Okay, natural killer lymphocytes, macrophages. So these are all the cellular barriers which digest the antigens. So phagocytes like WBC, example neutrophils or polymorphonuclear leukocytes, PMNL, we also call it as neutrophils or PMNL, monocytes, natural killer lymphocytes, macrophages, they are all the cellular barriers. So we discussed about the physical barrier, skin. Second one was the physiological barrier like saliva, gastric HCl, and tears. They are the physiological barriers. Cellular barriers, we have the neutrophils or PMNL, polymorphonuclear lymphocytes, leukocytes, sorry, monocytes. These natural killer leukocytes, lymphocytes. Then we have the macrophages. So these are the cellular barriers, third one. The fourth one is cytokine barriers. So virus infected cells secrete a cytokine protein called interferon. This interferon, it protects non-infected cells from further viral infection. So the virus infected cells, they produce cytokine protein. So the virus infected cells, they secrete a cytokine protein called interferon. And this interferon protects non-infected cells from further viral infection. So we call it as cytokine barriers. Remember interferons. So interferons are produced in response to the virus infection. So virus infected cells secrete a cytokine protein called as interferon. So interferon protects in non-infected cells from further viral infection. So these are the four types of innate barriers, that is physical barrier, physiological barriers, cellular barrier, and cytokine barriers. So we have discussed about this. First line of defense, they are also called as, and acquired immunity. So these are acquired by vaccination or from various other sources. We acquire the immunity that we will be discussing in the later class. So still the immunity and innate immunity is sufficient for today's class. So we'll be discussing about the others in the next class. So please make a note of the daily practice question. Before that, answer your attendance also. So any doubts or clarifications with whatever we have done as of now, dear students, so we can get it clarified.